there's some huge barriers towards like even learning the simplest biotechnology stuff, and those need to be brought down.
Welcome to the Greener Grass Podcast from Bluebird Botanicals. I'm your host, Lex Pelger. Growing big, beautiful cannabis plants is a satisfying way to produce THC and CBD. But is it the most efficient? Most of the energy and biomass goes into the stalk and the leaves, creating more work for us later when we try to extract our beloved chemical compounds from the chaff. That's why Kevin Chen founded Hyacinth Bio. They're a science-based startup that hacked yeast cultures, genetically engineering these single-celled organisms to produce cannabinoids. This kind of genetic engineering could increase production and energy efficiency on a large scale, and he wants more people to learn about it. So if you're curious about biohacking, gene editing, and the future of cannabis chemistry, please enjoy this conversation with Kevin Chen. This show is brought to you by Bluebird Botanicals, to spread education about cannabis and other things on the greener side of life. Bluebird CBD oil comes from farms in southern Colorado and is grown using only water, soil, and sunlight. Go to bluebirdbotanicals.com for more info. Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to be here today with Kevin Chen, who is the CEO and co-founder of Hyacinth Bio. Thanks so much.
Hey, Lex. Nice to meet you and excited to be here today.
All right. So I wanted to hear first, before we get on to your company, what you're up to. Did you always feel like you were a scientist, even when you were little?
That's a good question. I think so. In hindsight, I remember like as a kid looking at like, you know, some kids wanted to be firemen, others like astronauts. And then like somehow I think maybe I drove past like a science lab one day and looked in the window. And then as a kid, I remember that moment being like, oh, maybe I'll be a scientist when I'm older. And then I kept studying science as I went along and always enjoyed it. So yeah.
And your background is in biochemistry, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And so where did you go to school and did you get to work on any projects while you were there?
Yeah, I went to school at Queen's University in Kingston, Ontario. It's where I did my bachelor's in biochemistry. And I worked on a couple of projects that were for an engineering design kind of competition, but for genetic engineering. And it's called the International Genetically Engineered Machine Competition, or iGEM. And it's definitely worth looking up for anyone who's like at all interested in genetic engineering. It's kind of this huge, you know, 4,000 students from around the world, all over the place, come and gather, and they present their super hardcore, interesting, like genetic engineering projects, which range from like engineering a bacteria to play like rock, paper, scissors, to engineering bacteria to, you know, cure cancer kind of thing. So that was kind of where one of the first few projects that I worked on that were like, you know, genetic engineering related, and were really looking towards solving problems. And then that's where a lot of my inspiration towards, you know, what I do now came from.
Interesting. Was there also a business aspect to that project? There were a certain amount of funds you had and you had to watch out how to run this project?
Yeah, pretty much. We ended up getting lucky with I guess both of the years that I participated in the competition, now I'm a judge for it. We were doing environmental related projects and got money from one of the some sort of foundation connected to the oil sands in Alberta. We had to go out and get our own funding and get professors to help us and hire our own team and then come up with our own ideas for, you know, how you might solve like a problem in the world and then trying to engineer an organism to do it. So that whole process was a lot of, you know, what we did in the earlier days of starting up Hyacinth was exactly the same thing almost.
Wow. So what great practice. And what was the project that you were working on? What kind of genetic machine?
Let me think about how to phrase this. We always pick like these, this is just like a bunch of undergrads. So I was like maybe like 20 at the time or 18 or something like that even. And then just thinking of like what would be cool to like engineer an organism to do. One of the products that we worked on, which overall went okay in the end, I think, we did well at the competition, was to engineer these microscopic worms, called nematodes, and engineer them to actually be able to, seek out and destroy any chemicals that are harmful in the environment. So the idea would be like, okay, if there's a bunch of pesticides in like a farm area, or if there's a bunch of like a chemical spill of some sort, then you'd be able to release these worms into the wild, and they would kind of, instead of just swimming around and normally eating their regular food sources, they would also go out and find these nasty chemicals that are going to be bad for you, and then eat those instead. And that was the crazy idea that we came up with back in 2011.
That is a crazy idea.
Yeah, but it's super fun, and we got our results weren't super great, because that's like a really lofty challenge to try and like pursue and get real tangible data out of. But the whole process in the competition was lots of fun, and the team was awesome, and is actually also one of my co-founders of Hyacinth was on that team as well.
And I guess doing a project like that in some ways isn't nearly as crazy as trying to become an officially licensed dealer of cannabinoids in this day and age.
That project, if we continued it, I'm sure would have had a lot of the similar kinds of challenges as far as, you know, how you actually implement a project like that. And we investigated like a little bit of that, you know, in our student project, but it's still just a student project. And then nowadays, yeah, it's we're swimming through our own sea of regulatory considerations that are changing all the time and always getting more exciting. And sometimes it's fun, sometimes it's stressful, but usually it's fun.
And so can you tell me about the founding of Hyacinth and how it went and the challenges?
Yeah, for sure. So back in 2014, when we first got started, it was myself and at the time we were four other co-founders. I had worked for another startup the year beforehand and had some experience there and had some connections through them to an investment fund. And there was a new startup accelerator program, which is now called Rebel Bio, and it's based in London, and it's specifically for biotechnology companies. And they had just started off and were having their first cohort, and I heard about it through my friends. And then with my friends who were became my co-founders, we were just kind of like brainstorming ideas and thinking about things, because there was this really interesting opportunity to start a company and to get this kind of like, you know, early stage startup support that basically didn't exist in the world at the time. There were really, you know, very few opportunities to get early stage funding for startups, and most of it was all the funding would go towards more like academic spinouts or to just like regular grants and stuff. And so this provided like a unique opportunity for us to get started. So we started thinking of ideas and made our list of various potential targets or problems or challenges or like products that we could make. And these things ranged from the opioids to the cannabinoids to like other flavors and fragrances and other things you could be making using yeast, because that was kind of our main skill set, was to engineer a yeast to make something. After investigating the cannabinoids a bit more and we ended up getting into the program, and that was like awesome. We gave a little pitch, which was like in hindsight quite bad. I think I'll reflect on that one in like a few years and be like, my God, how did we get that into this program? That's kind of where the idea originated, and then investigated a lot more and understood kind of how the cannabinoid industry is developing and where it was at in 2014. And now it looks a lot different, and it's in many ways met the expectations that we had back then. And still has the same sort of issues as far as the kinds of things that we're able to address with our technology. So so far so good as far as, you know, coming from that idea and having the right predictions at the time. But that's kind of where it all got started, was a few of us who had a few different ideas and then had a really nice opportunity to get some early stage investment.
And can you talk about the business model and where it's been and where you hope to see it going?
A lot of it so far has been focused around, I mean, in general, our activity is mostly R&D, because this is like, we're trying to create this new thing that's never really existed before. And that's been pretty challenging and takes a lot of investment, a lot of time and a lot of specialized skills, but we're doing quite well for ourselves. And then as far as our actual business, we are, like, our fundamental technology allows us to produce any of the active components of cannabis using a strain of yeast instead of having to grow plants. And so there's a gap in the industry where you can grow more plants and invest more money to grow more plants, but it always is going to have some kind of like fixed cost metric where there's light and there's energy and there's time that it goes into processing these plants. It ends up being a very arduous and expensive process. And it's nothing like, you know, the process that they use to make aspirin, for example, which is like 150,000 tons of product that gets shipped around worldwide. But at the same time, there's like this, that's kind of where a lot of cannabinoid products are going, and they're starting to have these more broad applications and starting to get applied to like more different kinds of therapeutics. And you're going to need that kind of scale if you want to deliver a truly global supply chain of these things. And that's kind of where our business model comes in, where it's about creating that supply where we can actually, using our technology, fulfill orders that are over a ton or over 10 tons or over, hopefully over 1,000 tons one day, and not have any issues as far as like quality control or like delayed supplies or whatever else. And these are all kinds of issues that we see in the cannabis industry today that people are still struggling with. And then even the scale issue alone is deafening, I think, where it's the biggest grows that people are boasting about are in the range of like, you know, 1 to 2 tons or something like that, as far as like pure cannabinoid that actually comes out of it. And that's just, you know, such a small fraction of what is going to be out there in the future. There definitely needs to be something has to change about this.
Can you walk us through the basics of how you get yeast to produce cannabinoids and what you have to do?
So the basic concept has been around since the 1970s, when insulin was made using a bacteria instead of having to isolate it from like an actual pig's like pancreas. So the idea there, and the same thing applies here, was that you can take the gene for insulin from a human and put that gene into a bacteria, and then the bacteria will also produce insulin. And then you can grow this bacteria in large scales and be able to supply the world without having to slaughter, you know, hundreds of millions of pigs. In our case, it's about taking the genes that are normally found in cannabis and putting those genes into a yeast cell. So the yeast now has ability to produce THC or to produce CBD or whichever one that we choose. And then after a lot of engineering and process design and scale up, then we can start doing that same thing where we can grow our strains of yeast at large scales instead of having to grow so many plants. And the actual physical process would look a lot more like a fermentation, where you're adding sugar and your water and your strain of yeast, and you're letting that grow for about a week, and then you isolate your product at the end. And this is how a lot of other, I mentioned insulin as one example of like a popular fermentation-based product that exists right now. But there's all kinds of food ingredients like citric acid or lactic acid, or if you want to think even more basically, like, you know, ethanol is a fermentation product. And that's it all has to come from these organisms that are all engineered in some way, shape, or form.
That's a very fascinating solution. And so you have to identify these synthase pathways. So do you have them for other cannabinoids besides THC and CBD?
Yep, we've got a good list of an always growing list of hundreds or thousands of different genes that would be useful in this pathway. And it's interesting to kind of seek out these ones that, like, the one for THC is kind of like out there. There's a few different options as far as how you can make these things. But some of the more interesting ones, like THCV and CBDV, are out there and are being explored. And I can't speak too much to exactly, you know, what are more unique approaches as far as, you know, solving these problems. But this is kind of where, you know, we start hitting the edge of science, where it's like, okay, there's not really a clear way to just pull these genes from there, put them here, and then suddenly you have product being made. There's all kinds of different challenges that are there, and a lot of stuff that's not really known. And that's part of the challenge and also part of the fun of what we do.
And it's interesting that you're not working in an academic space where you're just trying to solve a problem. You're trying to solve a problem at scale using a business model. What was it like to start learning business skills through a biotech company and apply that to how you ferment and how you separate and how you purify these yeast-producing cannabinoids?
Yeah, so coming from that was a big jump actually when we started out where I was coming from a biochemistry background and studied mostly science, and then I was put through this startup accelerator program, which gave me all these business skills. And I remember my first pitch being kind of like, oh, and here's all this stuff about the science and which genes we're using and blah 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 and all these nice things. And then the investor who was like the mentor for the program was like, cut all of that. Like all of that is just like jargon. Nobody understands it, and you're just losing people, and people get bored, and they don't. And it's just like, you just sound smart, and you don't actually like convince people of anything that's like, valuable. And so, there's a bunch of like, yeah, these really interesting learning curves that you had to get on to actually start to, learn to communicate this company and communicate what we're doing, and to convince investors to join the team, and then and convince employees that they should join your company, and all these different kinds of really interesting scenarios that I've had to go through. But a lot of it is, I mean, as far as coming up with the business and comparing that to science, it's interesting to draw this line that goes straight from like the discovery of something all the way to the actual product of something, and that's something that is very rarely done, I think, in academia or in academic science, where you actually have something that started out in your lab and then actually becomes a product. Usually the goal is like to publish a paper and then you kind of walk away from it. Or somebody else is supposed to pick that up, or you try and spin out a company eventually and then you have something. But for us, the there's so much more reality to deal with, where if we don't succeed, then like that kind of means it doesn't mean that we have to do another year of our PhD or something like that. It means that our company fails and we have to start over from scratch, maybe in the worst case scenario. And I think that is something else that's really important, that I actually value that a lot in my opinion. Where and this might be part of like my initial spark to becoming an entrepreneur, was that I wasn't very satisfied with the idea of doing science in a way that just kind of leaves it at this publication stage. I'd rather see science become products and to accelerate that process of research and development, so that instead of just always wondering and always tinkering around labs, we can spend our money a lot more effectively and actually create something real that people are actually going to use and that people actually need someday, and that need right now almost,
And so, what advice would you offer to scientists out there who are listening who might want to become entrepreneurs as well?
So I think for all scientists that are, or people that are interested in science, or young scientists or old scientists, or even if you're in high school, you should always kind of be looking for, what kind of lifestyle you want to lead in the future, and what you really care about as like, the most important thing, and what kind of boundaries you want to push as far as your own work and your own personality and what you want to test yourself with. So for example, for me, I was somebody who wasn't very satisfied by the academic system, and I felt like I needed to do more things, needed to work in smaller teams and work faster on really interesting projects and get things done that are going to be higher risk and higher impact. And I wasn't going to wait around, another 10 years of education and thousands of dollars to get to become a professor or something like that, and then have my own job of some sort. And I don't see myself being a professor, where it's more about like sitting around and writing grants, and I love to teach, but I'm not that interested in teaching lecture halls of like 300 bored students or something like that, right? So if you as a scientist really want to be on that path, then that's a path that you can be on. But I think what I if I give advice to my past self, it's that, there's more than what people talk about it there as far as like science careers. There's stuff in like art and design and policy, and it's not just like an industry academia kind of like choice you have to make of some sort. We can, as scientists, apply our skills to all different kinds of different fields, and even you're a biochemist, and you're in like doing more like media stuff right now. And I think you're so it doesn't mean your degree is wasted. It means that you can use your degree to communicate more science, which is awesome. We need more people that are like that. And that's something that is hard to remember as you go along and as you go through your, you know, your degree programs and stuff, and you keep thinking about this one track that you're on. You kind of should be and should definitely feel free to explore, and should definitely explore into like all kinds of areas that might be interesting for you.
It's great advice. Yeah, it's an exciting time to be in science with much more unique opportunities of how to apply yourself. Because I am very impressed that you jumped in and founded this. It's a crazy great idea, and it's very cool that you're making it fly.
Yeah, and maybe another point of advice is to just, you know, maybe you should just jump into the deep end, you know, and see if you can float. And part that's, you know, a little bit of how we got started as well. It wasn't like you know, I've had my parents aren't entrepreneurs, and I don't have that many entrepreneur friends back then when I started. And it was really just like me seeing an opportunity and then going for it. And if it didn't work out, then, you know, I'd be doing something else today, obviously. But so far it's looking pretty good for me. So people shouldn't be that afraid to just, you know, go for something and see what happens. And then you can always, if in the worst case, you can always go back to school, I guess.
And you also mentioned policy in there. And I was curious about being in Canada and being a biotech company and all the hassles of business as well. What was it like on the governmental side of becoming an officially licensed dealer of cannabinoids?
This was a really interesting and eye-opening process, I think. And I don't know if you've, with your work and with your other interviews, if you've gotten any insight on this, you know, how the government looks at these things, or how various governments look at these things. In Canada, we overall had a really good time. We can speak to like Canada's forwardness in terms of actually pushing these regulations forward to kind of our process, and in that, you know, we got a lot of support as we went through the different levels of regulation. And for us, it started out with like an R&D permit, where it's like, okay, you're allowed to have your tiny lab and your tiny, you know, just amounts of stuff, and then becoming a licensed dealer, which is now that's part of the old system. That was a new system that we're transitioning over to, you know, getting to through these processes were really difficult always. And it was always like, I'm trying to think of like, I think a good defining way of talking about, you know, how this happened was, you know, being on the phone with somebody from Health Canada, and going through like, you know, explaining what we're doing, and then they kind of give an answer to like, oh, then we should think you should be in like this category of things. And then we're like, well, actually, it doesn't really work out for us because we're trying to do this, this, and this, and this. And then they're kind of like, oh. And there's like a bit of a silence of like pause where they're like the I guess whoever's hired there is trying to like, you know, think about like what should happen next, actually. And then they almost always they're like, you know, embracing like the science, and they understand the impact of the technology. And then they're like, okay, well, we'll set up another call like next week with this other people, or we'll, you know, revise your application this way, and then this will be fine. Or like, we'll do this to help, you know, make this make sense for you guys. And so, you know, it's been, some people complain about this all the time, where about like regulations and stuff, but I think, in our case, where it's, about, you know, creating new technologies, and about embracing them, and about, being, proactive and supportive in your regulations, I think Canada's been awesome at that.
Wow. It must be nice being somewhere so forward thinking. There's a lot of jealousy here south of the border about how far ahead Canada is on cannabinoids and harm reduction and, you know, general civility and treating people like humans.
Yeah, for sure. And it's different challenges everywhere. And, you know, when at some point, you know, we'll be doing business in the US as well in the future. But I don't know when exactly we'll get into that. Wait until regulations do shake themselves out a bit more. It's the US is a different country, and Canada's fortunately, you know, we've had the right kind of government who's willing to push for these things, and that's worked out for us so far. I think there's plenty of naysayers in Canada who think, you know, that this whole legalization thing isn't going to work out in the end, and you know, we'll see one day if their, you know, worst case scenario predictions come true or not. But so far, I think things are going well, and we feel really supported in terms of how we're approaching this and the science that we're doing.
And you mentioned community as well, and it seems like something that your company and you are passionate about. Can you tell a little bit more about your involvement with makerspaces and community biology?
Yeah. So that's funny. This is like very much a side project for me, but I love to promote it anyways and get more people thinking about, you know, doing more community projects and finding, you know, new ways to help communicate and teach science and technology. And so I've been helping to run a fairly large makerspace around Montreal for the past few years. And that's been a fun, like, entrepreneurial project of mine. And also, since I'm a biochemist, then I'm also pretty interested in integrating, you know, biochemistry into these kinds of spaces. And now there's this whole movement called do-it-yourself biology, or sometimes it's called biohacking, or sometimes it's called community biotechnology, where the idea is to encourage more people to just kind of engage in biotechnology research or science or whatever in more of a hobbyist or more of an accessible way. That doesn't have the access barriers of, like, you know, I guess in Canada it's like maybe more like $5,000 to $10,000 of tuition. In the US it's more like maybe $20,000 of tuition, I guess, depending on where you go. So there's some huge barriers towards, like, even learning the simplest biotechnology stuff, and those need to be brought down. Whether it's for, you know, just for the sake of, like, society, but also for the future of technology and for getting kids to be inspired and for getting anyone to be inspired to develop the next big and interesting things in technology. And we see this all the time in, like, electronics and in software stuff, and we want to see more of that kind of interest and motivation in biotechnology as well.
And actually, my last two questions are about the future and forward thinking. And the first one's a little bit science fiction-y. With this kind of work and being able to use yeast to produce many different compounds, are you surprised that the drug cartels haven't picked up on the fact that you could be using yeast to produce opioids already? I guess I've always envisioned a future where in every city there's some apartment that's pumping out the opioids for that city, so they no longer have to come from Afghanistan. And it, you know, the pressures of the black market will cause that to be a viable option.
Yeah, that's a good speculation, and it's been many years that people have speculated on this topic. And I guess where we fall in it is, like, along with the rest of the cannabis regulations, where it's like, okay, now it's kind of okay to grow at home, at least in Canada and some of the US as well. But this future of where, you know, everything's made using yeasts and people can do this in their apartments, that could show up one day as far as, you know, what the future might hold. But for now, it's, you know, it is really challenging to get a yeast to produce the thing that you want it to produce, as long as that thing isn't, like, ethanol, and to get it to produce something that it really is not used to producing at all, like a cannabinoid or an opioid. So even the opioid kind of work that's published out there right now, and this is, like, it's not our area, but there's a few companies that are developing this more commercially. It's still really, really early, and to get a yeast to actually produce at, like, relevant amounts is extremely challenging, and to get it to isolate that properly is also very challenging, and is definitely beyond, you know, the and this is, like, you know, the smartest of the smart people that have done biotechnology for years that are trying to do this stuff. So for me, it's not really a big concern that, like, somebody in their basement's going to suddenly figure out how to, like, magically get a yeast to produce opioids and then create another problem. There's just too much of a barrier in terms of the technology that's required, not just to, like, do the engineering, but also even the process of actually doing, like, the growth and the purification that ends up being very specific for each product. And there's some really interesting projects, I think in the last year or 2 years ago, that a few researchers published on this topic of opioid production. And then one of them even went and tried to test this out in, like, a home brewing setting, where they took their strains of yeast and put them in a home brewing culture, and then clearly didn't see any kind of opioid being produced because, like, yeah, it's just too low yields. And I don't know if that helped, you know, address many of, like, the public's opinions about, you know, this kind of work and how controversial it is, but it at least, you know, provided, you know, an actual, like, physical basis that, like, no, you can't just do this at home. And the science is quite a bit more complicated than that. And it'll take a few more years until most of the stuff is even brought to market at like a pharmaceutical, like, you know, top science level. And then maybe in like 100 years from now, there'll be tools that are going to be good enough to do this at home. But then still there'll be, you know, it's the, there's a lot of people who are already discussing the regulations of these kinds of things and these possible scenarios that I'm sure will have a whole range of solutions to kind of address these things before the issues start to crop up. So yeah, I think that's my long-winded answer to that question and that scenario. It's a fun one to speculate on. A lot of people speculate on that.
Yeah, good. It's a great answer. And it also assures me I can still sell this as a science fiction story. It's still far enough away. I'll write it up that way.
Yeah, and it's shown up in here places here and there. I think we were in the sixth or seventh season of Mr. Robot at some point. Somebody tweeted me and said, like, oh, you're in Mr. Robot. Go check this out. And then there's this quote from this guy being like, oh, yeah, you can make THC in yeast nowadays. And like oh, geez, okay. Wonder where they got that idea.
You're making it.
Maybe, yeah.
And speaking of, the last question is, what is the future of Hyacinth and what are you most excited about?
I am most excited about the latest thing that happened with us was our new investment round from Organigram in September. And that's been kind of a long ways coming as far as, you know, that level of funding and that level of relationship where it sets us really on a clearer path towards like success and towards like production and towards the market. And I think every startup probably goes through this at some point in their cycle where there's like, you know, some, either you need like a bunch more investment or maybe you need to figure out this key thing with your product to actually get it to be marketable. And then after you reach that point, then you've crossed that, you know, maybe it's a valley of death, I guess, in some cases. And suddenly things are just exponentially different where, you know, even the way that, like I remember 2016, it was still just me and the three other co-founders and we were, paying ourselves just barely enough money to survive until we could get to the next like key milestone or get to the next like little bit of funding that came in. But still being able to get, you know, reasonable science done. And now things are different where it's like, you know, we've done a lot of the science and that's going to form a good basis for the next science that we're going to do. And then this next science that we're going to do is going to be so much better and so much faster and have so many more people around it that's just going to be so much more exciting. And, you know, we're going to have our little like holiday party this weekend. It's going to be like, you know, we can almost fill a bar with people now because we're such a big team. Whereas beforehand it was like, you know, we just go to a bar and hang out for and have a couple of drinks. Now it's like we have to reserve stuff in advance, and that's much different and also very exciting and stressful in different ways, but it's all good stuff. But this sort of phase of like, yeah, things are different now. It's super exciting to kind of be on this team and to be building it and to have so many more people involved, and things are gonna move really fast for us, and so we're excited to, you know, see what happens next. We're excited to be looking for, you know, the next business partners that we want to have on, the next companies that we want to partnerships with, and like the next kinds of ideas that people have that are going to be like, you know, global scale pharmaceuticals or just really great, maybe really great consumer products that are going to come up, because that's ultimately where we're headed, is like, you know, we want to find these ideas and the companies that are going to be the global leaders in this space, and find the unique ideas that are kind of going to be like the mass market product of in the cannabis world, and be the ones that are able to help them get to the global scale that they need to be. And now we're so much closer to being able to make that commitment compared to, definitely compared to like 5 years ago and yeah, even compared to like 2 years ago.
It's a really inspiring story of science entrepreneurism. And I thank you so much for sharing it.
Yeah, no problem.
Well, Kevin, thank you so much for sharing. And we wish you the best luck in the future and hope we'll get a chance to check in a little bit down the road and see how everything's going.
Yeah, please do. And really nice to chat.
Thanks, Kevin. Greener Grass is a Bluebird Botanicals podcast. Their CBD oil supports a healthy body and a strong endocannabinoid system. They've got friendly customer service who can answer any of your questions, and the number is right there at the top of their webpage. But, per the FDA, they won't be able to make any medical claims for these nutritional supplements. That's also the reason you'll hear little about CBD on this show. There's no need for us to add more evidence about CBD when a simple Google search will give you more than you can read in a month of Sundays. So this show covers the cannabis world and more with editorial freedom from Bluebird Botanicals. Thanks for joining the Greener Grass podcast. As always, our audio alchemist is Matt Payne. The Gypsy Jazz theme music comes from Brett Van Donsel. Our beautiful bird sounds are courtesy of Lang Elliott. And I'm your host, Lex Pelger, wishing you a bright green day.